Okay, thank you, Mr. Chairman. Good afternoon, everyone. Obviously, I will be less funny than you are, but finally, I am very relaxed because, as I view, I never publish in this fake news journal, so everything is okay. So, evaluating bulimic status, is Venacaba evaluation readable? So, I would like really maybe to discuss on this first slide because maybe a new paradigm is coming about the management of fluids. Microcirculation could be a clue, but probably also that on the macrocirculation side, we have to better select and characterize our patients that really need to be seen, and probably not patients that have a free responsiveness prediction. I think it's really a key point. And we have probably many pieces now in the literature to support this concept. The first one, as you know, many years ago, that more fluids that you give to your patients, worse is the outcome, is the survival, while, of course, in this study, you have many potential bias. I like really this supplementary table in the paper just published in the JAMA Journal, the paper by Glenn Hernandez. And you can see that that's really fascinating, that if you look at patients admitted in the ICU for septic shock, you can see in gray the patients that finally will respond, who were responders to fluids. You can see that after 2 hours following the admission, there were only a few patients responders to fluids. So is it really a key point, I mean, in the ICU after the first hours? I am not so sure, finally. And I don't know, but maybe there is a lecture later on this study. Could be a new concept, so it's a pilot study, there is no outcome. This is just about the feasibility and the safety of applying something different to manage the fluids in the emergency department here, not in the ICU. But you can see that they compared the restrictive fluid arm with the usual care. And what was interesting, that in the restrictive fluid arm, by definition, they gave less fluids, but also they start much quicker norepinephrine infusion, with probably maybe in the future that we will discover that it could have some deleterious effect on the microcirculation, but at least you could lower the fluid overload in your patients. So can we evaluate the volumic status with the Venacaba? I think that we really need to be humble, because if you look at the distribution of volume into the circulation, most of the blood is into the venous reservoir that you cannot analyze. As you know, there are some data regarding the evaluation of the mean systemic filling pressure, but it's not so convinced to be applied in usual care at the bedside. You have 15% in the systemic arteries, 5% in the small arteries and capillaries, including the pulmonary capillaries. And finally, you have 9% into the pulmonary circulation and 8% in the heart in diastole. It means that you have 17% in the thorax, and just keep in mind this number that could be interesting to discuss the interest of the Venacaba. So about the Venacaba, as you know, we have two Venacaba, the inferior Venacaba and the superior Venacaba. The inferior Venacaba, here you have a subcostal view of the inferior Venacaba. And in spontaneously breathing patients, as you know, the inferior vena cava may collapse during aspiration compared to the expiration. This is the opposite in a positively ventilated patient, completely adapted to the respirator, while now the IVC may dilate during the inspiration compared to the expiration. And the point about the rationale to use the inferior vena cava to manage the fluids is this probably relationship between the CVP and the inferior vena cava diameter in mechanically ventilated patients. And you can see that maybe, sorry, or to go back, no, go on. Maybe if you are on the steep part of the relationship, they could have some fluid preload reserve that may be beneficial to your patient by giving more fluids. But one of the limitations of the IVC is that the IVC is not in the thorax. So it's an indirect parameter of the amount of blood that you have in the thorax, which is finally the point that you want to evaluate. If you look at this narrative review published in the JAMA a couple of years before, you have the different studies. regarding inferior vena cava and especially its respiratory variation to predict the response to fluids. You can see that there are contrasting results. It seems that most studies were positive studies, so the IVC appeared as accurate, while the last one was very a bad study with very bad results. So it was in mechanically ventilated patients. In spontaneously ventilated patients, you can see two studies with once again contrasting results. So first, regarding spontaneously breathing patients, just to stop the discussion here, that's a big problem. Look at this patient with acute asthma, absolutely not hypovolemic. Maybe his fluid responsiveness, I don't know, but look at the complete collapse of the inferior vena cava during each inspiration, just because of the deep depression of the intrathoracic pressure. No, nothing to see with the volemia. About mechanically ventilated patients, so two speakers show you this study that we conducted in unselected shocked patients, and just to show you the results regarding the IVC and respiratory variation. So, the area under the curve is not good, but another information that I may give you is that the feasibility was not so good, because in more than 20% of patients, we were unable to record the IVC respiratory variation because of the obesity, because of drain, because of many things that render the quality of the echo not adequate enough. However, sometimes I have to say that you may use it because it may work. Look at this study, this patient, so the IVC is very small. You see the airway pressure trace and the IVC delays during each tadic ventilation. The cardiac index was 2.4, and because the patient has some signs of tissue hyperperfusion, we decided to give some fluids. Look at that the cardiac index significantly increased, and we continue to monitor the patient after the first step of fluids. And you can see now that the IVC was not small at all, but still dilating during tadic ventilation. This is why, because the patient was not in a very good shape, we decided to give a second step of fluids. And you can see now that the cardiac index increased, but that's interesting because the IVC significantly delayed. Probably we gave too much fluids at the end in this patient. The limited value now of the IVC diameter, which is very popular, especially in North America, they like very much to measure the diameter of the IVC. Just show you this slide. I think that beyond the area under the curve or the accuracy, probably the best approach is really to apply parameter or cutoff value very specific that you will have a response, or very specific that you will not have a response to fluids. And you can see that if you apply 10 millimeters here in this study for the response to fluid, or 27 millimeters for the non-response to fluid, you can see a specificity of 90%. And probably with the concept of restrictive approach, I think the sensitivity is not so interesting. And you show this slide. What about the respiratory variation of the superior vena cava? Probably more suitable to evaluate the amount of blood into the chest, because the SVC is into the chest, and the surrounding pressure of the SVC is the intrathoracic pressure. So you may have a good evaluation probably of the conflict between of the blood into the pulmonary circulation and the surrounding pressure, which is the intrathoracic pressure. Look at, for instance, this is, so you need a T study. So you can see here the superior vena cava in its longitudinal view, collapsing during each tadic ventilation, and you have the same picture here using the time motion study. So there is no cutoff here, there is just a collapse of the vessel during each tadic ventilation. And that's really key, I think, because this is a very old study published in Animals in 1960, something obvious, but interesting to remind, is that here you have the amount of blood into the pulmonary circulation using a thermodilution technique, and here you have the LV stroke volume. And a higher amount of blood into the pulmonary circulation, higher is the stroke volume. So probably the SVC could be interesting as a parameter to evaluate, once again, the interaction between the amount of blood into the pulmonary circulation and the respiratory symptoms. And this study has absolutely no interest in clinical practice. Just to show you that this is something that we published many years ago, regarding the effect of the passive leg raising of the respiratory variation of the superomina cava as a marker of this conflict between the amount of blood into the pulmonary circulation and the intrathoracic pressure. You have here at baseline a complete collapse of the vessel during tadiventilation, during the passive leg raising, just because we increase the amount of blood into the pulmonary circulation. You can see less variation with an increase in cardiac index, and this is after fluid expansion. It was confirmed indeed that we normalize completely the respiratory variation of the vessel. And so what about the results? This is the area under the recurve. The feasibility was very good, providing that you have a T probe in the unit and the patient is, of course, but it was the inclusion criteria, mechanically ventilated and adapted to the respirator. And once again, I think that beyond the magic cutoff value or the area under the curve, what was especially interesting in this study, that we tried to evaluate a cutoff value above which we had a very high specificity to predict the response to fluids. And you can see that I don't want to comment about the cutoff value because we don't care about the cutoff value, but you found a value above which the specificity was very high with a very low sensitivity, but once again, I think that we don't care about the sensitivity with this new concept of restrictive approach. And finally, I think that that's a little bit crazy maybe to consider that with one parameter, we will be able to characterize patients and characterize the cardiovascular phenotype in septic shock, including patients with hypovolemia. And this is what we try to assess here, not using only one echo parameter, but combining echo parameters and clinical parameters, including blood pressure, heart rate, and so on. And we were able, using a clustering approach, just to finally five different cardiovascular phenotypes during the early phase of the admission of septic shock patient. And you have especially, especially in the green, the hypovolemic patients, the phenotype, and you can see it was 70 patients, so close to 20% of the patient after the first 6 to 12 hours following the admission. You can see that the ejection fraction was normal, the aortic VTI was low, the right ventricular size was normal, and the respiratory variation of the superomina cava was elevated. If you want to have a roadmap, for instance, for this sub-phenotype, you can see that with a VTI below 16 centimeters, delta SBC higher than 39, let's say 40, we had a good prediction of the hypovolemic cardiovascular phenotype, but once again with a high specificity and a low sensitivity. So I conclude my lecture. A new paradigm, in my understanding, is coming, is to detect patients who really require fluids and not those who are fluid responsiveness. We need to be very humble as most of volume is in the venous reservoir and we do not have any information available at the bedside, at least in the usual care. IVC, diameter of respiratory variation, has important limitations, could be interesting in very extreme situations, but do we really need something in extreme situations? About the SBC collapsibility index, that's clearly a parameter of value as it reflects the conflict between blood into the thorax and the intrathoracic pressure. Thank you for your attention.